Good afternoon, and welcome students, faculty, staff, and our guests from the community to our second President's Leadership Lecture of 2017. My name is Eric Davis, and I'm the Provost and Vice President Academic at UFV. It's my pleasure to act as your MC this afternoon. UFV is located on the traditional unceded territory of the Stolo Nation. On our Abbotsford campus, we acknowledge the Sumas, Matsqui, and Kwantlen First Nations, our closest neighbors. At UFV, we know it's an honor to share our location near the mountains and the rivers, and we're grateful for the beauty in our valley. We all benefit from those who have preserved this land for our shared use. It is a privilege, and we thank the Stolo people. Welcome to UFV Chancellor, Dr. Gwen Point, and to our President, Dr. Mark Everett. The President's Leadership Lecture Series is Mark's idea. He established it in 2011. And the series brings inspirational leaders to UFV to share their ideas, to challenge us, and perhaps even to provoke us. We are very pleased to be joined in this presentation by the UFV Alumni Association. In keeping with UFV's strategic goals, these lectures focus on issues relevant to the social, cultural, economic, and environmental evolution of the Fraser Valley. They help spark dialogue, build awareness, and engage our community on topics of interest to us all. And we know today's speaker, Dr. Linda Frimer, will certainly engage us through these three objectives. Last year, I had the privilege of nominating Dr. Frimer for her honorary Doctorate of Letters. She graciously agreed to accept the award at convocation last year. She was recognized for her artistic, humanitarian, and philanthropic contributions and accomplishments. Now she has returned to UFV to share her passion for art with us. We are delighted to have Dr. Frimer and her husband, another Dr. Frimer, Dr. Michael Frimer, with us today. Earlier, Dr. Frimer toured UFV and spent time with our visual arts students and our Indigenous leaders. She has seen our art gallery and has brought her wisdom and her inclusive and healing approach to us. Born in the wilderness town of Wells, BC, and raised in Prince George, Dr. Frimer connected with nature early on, and it informed her artistic growth from the beginning. At an early age, she heard stories of the Holocaust from her own family, and compelled by a desire to reflect the pain of her people and work towards healing, she created art that examined both of these themes. 20 years ago, Dr. Frimer co-founded the Gesher Holocaust Project, a multidisciplinary group that helped Holocaust survivors and their children express their traumatic experiences through art, words, and therapy. Her affinity to nature has led her to support many worthy environmental causes. Her paintings for the Wilderness Committee, the Trans-Canada Trail, the Raincoast Environmental Foundation, and other groups have helped raise funds for wilderness preservation. Her work has also raised awareness of threatened forests and ecosystems. From an early age, Dr. Frimer has felt an affinity for the Aboriginal people she grew up near in rural BC. Her connection grew when she became friends with Cree artist George Littlechild, also a UFV honorary degree recipient, by the way. She shared an immediate connection with Littlechild through their common interest in incorporating family and history into their art. Both use vibrant colors, and people were struck by the fact that they use the same palette. And their collaboration has led to many art shows presented in venues up and down the west coast of Canada and the US. The two friends also collaborated in a book called In Honor of Our Grandmothers. More than 30 years after receiving her degree from Emily Carr University, Dr. Frimer's paintings and murals can be found in galleries, synagogues, churches, hospitals, hospices, schools, transition houses, and public and private collections. Her work exudes grace, beauty, color, and compassion. Linda Frimer's art is quintessentially British Columbian. It celebrates the BC landscapes by capturing their magical quality while conveying a sense that they are animated with spirit, a notion central to BC First Nations culture. But simultaneously, it captures the immigrant status and history of so many BC families by populating the landscapes and skies with images of her Jewish ancestors and symbols of her cultural heritage. Ideas of loss and recovery, reverence and regret, memory and maternal warmth permeate her work. Similar ideas are expressed in her historical paintings of the Holocaust, which magically redeem the victims of history, rendering them somehow no longer victims. But there is something more that unites her history and nature paintings. Dr. Frimer's work calls on us to fulfill our sacred duty to protect and revere our natural and cultural heritage. She writes, "There are two ways to love and honor creation. One is through our good deeds in the midst of humanity, and the other is in our reverence and care for our natural world." One could say her work is motivated by the Jewish concept of tikkun olam, to heal, repair, and transform the world through acts of kindness and justice. The power and beauty of Frimer's art call on us to repair a world we have torn through environmental devastation or persecution of others. Please join with me in welcoming Dr. Linda Frimer for her presentation, Evoking Creativity.
Thank you. President Mark Everett, Vice President and Provost Eric Davis, Chancellor Gwen Point, Event Coordinator Betsy Terpsma, Director of Marketing Dave Pinton, Shirley Hardman, Department of Aboriginal Affairs, Shelley Steffen, Department Head of Visual Arts, Darlene Glum, Administrative Assistant, and David Lees, Director of Advancement, and also First Nations Elder Terry, thank you for making this such a beautiful day. Thank you for the hard work and effort that you put into this remarkable university. Evoking Creativity. So take a look at the screen, and what do you see? Once upon a timelessness, before the beginning, there was nothing at all. There was no heartbeat, no point of a needle, and not an essence of substance. Before the beginning, there was no golden sun or silver moon. There was no color, and so, no black, no yellow, no red, and no white peoples to distinguish between. Before the beginning, there was no land to be taken away. There is in Kabbalistic lore the story of the creation of being, and so of seeing from out of nothingness. This is the story of the creation of our world and all life upon it. This is also the story of a soul's intimate creative journey through the wilderness of existence. Since you can describe it in words like formless, empty, and eternal, the concept of nothingness exists. Look at the blank paper. It expresses what is not present. Now imagine a spark of essence forming in the nothingness and then becoming an actual visual presence. It takes nothing to be aware of something. Now, how would you describe the very first visual sign of beginning? Draw it. Take your paper, your blank, endless paper, and draw a pencil point anywhere on it. This point not only expresses beginning and your presence on this paper, it marks both a visual exit and entry point between nothingness and creation. This tiny point marks the spot where art begins. If to be creative means to bring something new into existence, then our earth was our first creation. It began with darkness over the deep to become a container for all of life. Look at your point. It is the same as every other point created in this room. For Madame Blavatsky, a theosophist, the point was the nucleus of universalism, a place we all have in common, without distinction of race, creed, sex, caste, or color. Then she says, first there was involution, the descent of the divine spark into matter. Then that spark slowly climbs back up to be united with its source. In comparative religion, the point will be referred to as the hidden seed, the divine egg, and the root of roots, and also the creator's name. What happens in between becoming the point of creation and a return to the eternal? And how do we decipher the knowledge circulating in the water and the wind, in the elements, and buzzing in the indecipherable whispers of all of the ancestors to find our own purpose? We find our purpose by listening to each other's stories and by creating our own. Every human is an artist, and this is the main art we have, the creation of our story, Miguel Angel Ruiz. When were the first stories told on our earth? The prehistoric peoples told them visually. They were the first artists. Imagine stepping back and descending into an enormous dark cave where lions, mammoths, and bison are still stampeding and battling upon the walls. Imagine soaking your own hand in black paint made from iron oxide and placing your own lifeline upon this cave wall along with those first humans, and creating a visual symbol as a creative expression of your consciousness. These cave paintings are the first to reveal the constant emergence of creativity in history and to display the symbols that express the magic of creation, order the world, and imbue meaning that can be shared with others. As the artist of your own story, find what inspires you, and then, as the artist of your own story, find your own unique symbols. Like the first people, I draw my symbols from nature. They include the star, the moon, flowers, a pathway, trees, and birds. Art is magic, but how is it magic? It is magic in its metaphysical development. Or does some final transformation culminate in a magic reality? In truth, the latter is impossible without the former. If creation is not magic, the outcome cannot be magic, said Hans Hofmann. My cultural tradition of storytelling began thousands of years ago, somewhere west of the Jordan River, with the Hebrews' tribal emergence as an indigenous group. Sojourning through thousands of years in other civilizations, these oral first stories were continuously being rewoven, becoming at times obscured or enmeshed in other people's stories. They would resurface, enhanced, and often a bit taller. Perhaps one of the best storytellers was the Baal Shem Tov. Known as the Master of the Good Name, he was the mystical rabbi who founded Hasidism in Eastern Europe in the 1700s. He taught that it is the longing of the heart that creates the connections between others that may transcend into kindness, and that it is stories nurtured with subtle truths that evoke the longing of the heart the best. All sorrows can be born if you put them in a story or tell a story about them, said Karen Bixen. As the artist of your own story, nurture it with subtle truths and evoke the longing of your own heart. On Mount Sinai, the Creator spoke to a people through clouds of fire and a burning bush. While the First Nations believe the spirit of the Creator is in sky dwellers and in all of Mother Earth's creatures, these stories share kinship that evolves them both into literary art. No matter where they find themselves in history, all people have their stories. Imagine being able to trace your story back 5,000 years. Then imagine the First Nations tracing their story back 40,000 years. Then imagine the first conifer trees that appeared on Earth 300 million years ago. When you start talking about family, about lineage and history, you are talking about every person on Earth, said Alex Haley. And when you start talking about trees, I'm saying, you're talking about every life on Earth. We are all related. Some details of my own intimate story may have been forgotten in the telling, so I will do what my ancestor did sometimes and imagine them, often from the perspective of a little girl who was formulating them in her mind. Sometimes you have to make up things to tell truths that alter outcomes. Without the power of imagination, we lack the power to alter outcomes. So if we cannot imagine better outcomes in a better world, we cannot act to achieve these. Ruth Ozeki. So this is my story. My intimate family wandered off the pages of ancient biblical history through thousands of years. They took peril-filled journeys from old worlds where they left behind home, family, language, and culture. Through all their colorful escapades, I know my ancestors were creative. I know this because they survived. Anti-Semitism was so strong in Romania, where my father's family was from, that it became part of the national identity. The sanitation laws of 1895 forbade Jews from inhabiting certain areas. Their homes were demolished. Jewish doctors were forced to lose their positions. Jewish shopkeepers were beaten, their merchandise confiscated, and they were prohibited from selling their goods. The virulent attacks exploded with the bad harvests and the famine. This triggered a horrific pogrom. Cossack soldiers stampeded into villages, breaking down doors, perpetrating vile, degrading acts, murdering, looting, humiliating, breaking sacred ceremonial objects, and shattering precious families. On the other side of the world, in the wilderness of what would become the Cariboo region of British Columbia, where my father's family would flee to one day, the Carrier First Nations, living on their own tribal land, were being exploited by the arrival of more fiercely greedy explorers, many from the California Gold Rush of the mid-1800s. Lusting for gold, they brought with them the devastation of alcohol and the smallpox epidemic that, spreading like a wildfire, nearly decimated them. At first, the First Nations buried their loved ones in a traditional way, but as the epidemic grew, they were thrown into mass graves and their pit houses burned. At the end, there was no one left to bury the dead. Fearful that it might spread to the white population where it originated, the whites in larger communities evicted the First Nations and burned entire villages. Left behind are pictographs drawn on rocks by hands that would have fished and held babies on the banks of the Fraser. Art is left to witness the devastation. Art that is the seer of each epoch in history at this very time in Europe had moved from neoclassicism that glorified the past Roman art into the Romantic movement, which encouraged art that expressed the emotions, to then become mingled with realist painting that mirrored the growth of industry and idolized the present moment and immediate surroundings. Yet what havoc the present moment and immediate surroundings were subjecting upon the others, each a dignified and sacred soul, unique and equal to all the others in value. As the artist of your own story, insight will lead to seeing the disparity between the elements in your creation. My grandfather Isaac was only 15 years old that icy dawn when he attempted to absorb what might be his last look at home in Iași, Romania. He had to process the unreal sense that this might be the last time his mother might reach her two fingers from her lips to his forehead to bless him. She wraps you in your favorite scarf, the red one that she knit for you, and then you realize it. This parting is even harder for her. You are out the door then, in one vessel-shattering moment. Fragments of your broken self cling to the doorstep while you watch yourself outside, walking in the turmoil and struggling to keep up with the band of footwalkers determined to walk away from their known world. Walk, Isaac, and then run for your life. When you are frozen cold, your shoe soles torn, and your small provisions depleted, run harder. When a man is denied the right to live the life he believes in, he has no choice but to become an outlaw, said Nelson Mandela. I color Isaac running fast and furiously and not stopping or looking back until he reached the new world of Canada. Turning your tattered pockets inside out, they were empty. You must have had resilience, though, for with your almost non-existent English, you were able to procure provisions. You are beginning a Wild West journey now, following the construction of new Canadian Grand Trunk Railway westward and selling dry goods from a tent that you erected by the tracks. I see you there, grandfather, through the image of a tree. As evening descended, you would be a solitary figure alone in your stand and staring, staring, staring. I sat staring, 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 half lost, learning a new language, or rather a new language in a different dialect. So still were the big woods where I sat, sound might not yet have been born, said Emily Carr. Grandfather sat staring, 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 like Emily Carr. Stare long in the forest, listen to the stillness, and learn the language of the trees that need no sound to reach your heart. Imagine yourself uprooted and set down in a new existence. A tree rooted to earth represents a vertical connector to heaven that accesses in its ascent other states of being that can enable transformation. As the artist of your own story, lift your arms like branches above the trunk of your body and open your hands and reach for the sky. Your raised arms and your open hands are your creative tools for change. Sometimes an artist's first creation just might be to invent their own self. Close your eyes, everyone, around the dot that you've put on your paper, without lifting your pencil, with one continuous line, draw the image of yourself as a tree. These are the trees of self that were created by the two generations of the Holocaust experience. This is a drawing by a survivor. And this is a drawing by the second generation. Trees are the earth's endless effort to speak to the listening heavens. Rabindranath Tagore. Take a look at your tree and see how it speaks to you and how it speaks to the listening heavens. As the artist of your own story, envision yourself as the ancients did, as a tree infused with divine energy. My grandfather Isaac and his brothers, Jack and Harry, who had separately fled Romania, somehow managed to forge a trail back to each other in Canada. They were determined to continue their story just where it had been left off. As the artist of your own story, you need determination. They became enterprising pioneers, riding by horseback inside the Rocky Mountains, trapping furs and trading pelts with the First Nations in the bush of Alberta. My grandfather and his brothers needed to strengthen their own porous and fibrous selves first, but then they extended their heartwood to others, not of their shared root systems, and even to those not of their own species. As the artist of your own story, have reverence for all of life's forms. Isaac took time now to go to Chicago to find his cultured bride, Fanny, whose family had endured similar losses in Lithuania. He brought her to the backwoods of Alberta and into a strange new pioneering wilderness where she would have no foundation at all at first. I imagine her standing outside and alone in the deep evening darkness and gazing longingly up to the same moon in the vastness of sky, and her own family back in the city were also seeing the same moon that I now gaze up to see. The brothers built a first home. This is my grandfather's first home, with a big porch for their families to share. Grandmother was starting over, tearing into a new existence and rebirthing her pathway. As the artist of your own story, be ready to rebirth a new pathway. This is so fascinating for me to learn the story of my ancestors. Fur buying was a competitive business, and the Hudson's Bay Company had agents entrenched in the bush. Each spring, my grandfather and his brothers rode horseback into the Indian encampments to pick up the catch from their native friends ahead of the Hudson's Bay Company. Then the terrible flu epidemic of 1918 spread through the mountains, and at each of the stopping houses on their way, the brothers found dead bodies in need of burial. With no others well enough, most of the times, they took on this gruesome task. Facing this might re-trigger their own painful losses, yet they courageously did what they needed to do. I have learned a lot from trees, sometimes about the weather, sometimes about the animals, sometimes about the great spirits, said Chief Walking Buffalo. From their businesses, the brothers would extend credits and loans. I found this article in the archives in Edson. I'm reading it as it was written at the time. Indian pays debt owing 21 years. Louis Kalu, an Indian living at Kelly Lake, walked into Jack Spanner's store on Friday last, stepping up to Mr. Spanner and said, I owe you $85 and I want to pay it. I'm 90 years of age. My time on earth will soon be up and I want to be square with the world before I go. Caillou then plunked down the amount owing. He said, Jack Spanner is the best friend an Indian ever had. More than for their trapping and fur trading, the Spanner brothers were known for their kindness. They had been taught tikkun olam, which means the repair of the world, and knew that even if they were suffering, they must do more to help those who were suffering more. This is the secret of repair. As the artist of your story, do more to help others. We leave something of ourselves behind when we leave a place. We stay there, even when we go away, said Pascal Mercier. How much you look like her. Just a moment, I'll go back there. Oops, sorry. How much you look like her. How much you are like her, Lindela, my father would say to me. And then, how much my mother would have loved you. Sorry, I'm missing a slide here. Most people... Grandmother, you flickered there from that sacred place where I held the moon within my own heart. You flickered from my tender self, who sometimes felt that in her father's eyes she appeared to be a pale reflection of you. Grandmother reminded me of a sacred cedar tree, steady, righteous, and of high nature. She was fair in her greatness, and she nurtured on great waters of faith. She grew her sturdy roots down into the earth, and as she did, her trunk and branches reached for the sky. Well, sometimes home is a person. Gold wasn't finished in this neck of the woods yet, and either were my ancestors. Just 8 kilometers from Barkerville, At what had been a mere campsite for a wandering prospector named Fred Wells in 1934, a revolutionary new discovery would once again paint tall tales and cause a cozy town to rise from nowhere. This is Wells. While the rest of the world was reeling from the war and the depression, the residents of Wells would be tucked in to this isolated and safe haven. My handsome father, Jack, who's on the
right,
recreated the story of his father, Isaac, and brought his own big city bride, Annie, from Toronto into an isolated landscape. Now that the war was over and his duty served, they could take each other's hand and go on their own wilderness adventure. Jack was a dreamer and gold seeker who opened his own Spanish dry goods store in Wells. For a time, imagining could not get any better than reality in Wells. Looking back at their romantic wilderness love story, they are my celebrities, living separate from the rest of the world and yet completely immersed in it. I imagine their portraits as pop artist Andy Warhol would have created them in the 1960s. He said, "What's great about this country is that America started the tradition where the richest consumers buy essentially the same thing as the poorest. You can be watching TV and see Coca-Cola, and you know that the president drinks Coca-Cola, Liz Taylor drinks Coca-Cola, and just think, you can drink Coca-Cola too." Well, I liked that my parents could fit in completely the same, in my opinion, with the likes of Elvis, the president, and Liz Taylor, and the Wells Town's characters that included 40 Below, the Chinese launderer, Zip and Zoom, two sisters from England who were also the town's ladies of the night, and Lucky Swede, who had gold teeth. They had it, that natural end of the road familiarity that is easy and genuine. I imagine Annie in her pop portrait as a bright salmon pink with strawberry undertones, while Jack is a deep cobalt blue with a bit of forest green around the edges. As the artist of your story, you can imagine anyone and anything in any color you want. According to Kabbalah, the atoms in our blood, the electrons that spur impulses to the brain, the chemicals that make up our tissues, bones, and our urgings, our longings, in fact, and memories lingering in our soul's recollections and ingrained into our very being. All things share the same breath, the beast, the tree, the man. The air shares its spirit with all the life it supports, said Chief Seattle. Nature and culture were comprised of the same holy substance. It was elemental. Wells, her glorious mountains and forests, her carrier First Nation, were created from the dust of the celestial, and so was I. The baby girl being born in Wells did not know whether she was coming or going, or what color she was, only that she was birthed into a very cold wilderness that cast a tinge of yellow-blue light over everything. No wonder my favorite color in the world would come to be turquoise. As the artist of your own story, find your favorite color. It is one of your own personal symbols. Hospital. That was the hospital before, I think I showed you. Oops, I'm going forward. That's my father and I. I am silent like every newborn in my first moments of life. Silence contains the secrets from eternity. It knows from where I have come. From this tiny spot of universe, my first cry would rise straight upward with the smoke from the town's chimneys, as it does at 40 below zero freezing weather, heaven bent, as I tumbled into the world. Where am I? What is this place called Wells, and why is it so damn cold? White hospitals inside, white snowbanks outside, my whole world is white. The first of all colors is white. We shall set down white for the representative of light, without which no color can be seen, said Leonardo da Vinci. Nothingness has turned inside out and given birth to me. As I grow, will my sensing that we are all part of the same infinite consciousness empower me, and will my passion for a world filled with light create me into an artist? In Wells, the colored houses filled my senses. This was a free-spirited, disheveled town. Your colors issue forth, akin to new music, as they push boundaries and challenge the idea of where houses should be situated and how they should be painted. Piles of discarded picnic baskets and overturned canoe, bulky cast-off televisions and radios with twisted antennae jostle amid rusted barbecues, unhinged doors, snowmobile parts, plastic planters and flattened garden hoses in your yards. They tell stories of a rush to establish home, followed by another rush to discard it. Near the time of my birth in Wells in the late 1940s, color field painting was beginning to emerge in the United States. Several artists sought to devise a modern art that connected with the primordial emotions locked in ancient myths. Color field painting would mark a major development in abstract painting, as it created figure and ground as one, while the space of the picture, conceived as a field, seemed to spread out beyond the edges of the canvas. The entirety of Wells, from its mountain of mine tailings to the smoke rising from a nearby lumber mill, was this color field that oozed off the map to ambiguously blend into forever. Upon my birth, my father called his father Isaac and his brother Morris and Prince George at the original Spanner's Menswear. My grandfather had long ago traded in his horse and cowboy hat for a car and made quite a spectacle as, heavy-footed on the gas pedal, he zoomed and honked around the loop of town. "Ah, it's a girl on that," my Uncle Morris repeated to me over and over. My father's firstborn was supposed to be David, his son, and then would come his daughter, Linda. Unlike the Carrier First Nations who lived in Wells and whose child's name would be communicated to them through a dream or envisioned by the grandmothers, as they bent over the cradle, my father had chosen both my name and my birth order before my out-of-sequence arrival. "We adopted you from an Indian tribe," my father would also tease, looking at his olive-skinned, brown-eyed, and dark-haired daughter. I would come to experience the surging of a fierce combination of defiance and dignity as soon as I understood that my feminine presence was not being honored enough, and then when others who had been on this land long before little me or the other newcomers, and then the land itself, was also not being honored enough. I would come to experience the same defiance for the trees, for those life-giving miracles of nature, when exploited like a person, have nowhere to grow. Soon the landscape that surrounds me would become a firmament of golden meadows and mountains and rivers and trees that shine into the tree of my own life to inspire wonder so astounding that it will return me to moments of silence. As the artist of your own story, fill your senses. "The trees had spirits, the wind spoke," said Jennifer McHonan. The term Mahan in Hebrew indicates a parallelism between the spiritual and physical domains. Every stirring in the world below will cause an equal stirring in the world above. Every soul harmed and every tree thoughtlessly taken causes an equal reaction in heaven. Darkness cannot drive out darkness. Only light can do that. Hate cannot drive out hate. Only love can do that, said Martin Luther King. The artist Marc Chagall wrote, "There's a single color on an artist's palette which provides the meaning of life and art. It is the color of love. In those early innocent years of my soul's earthly adventure, I saw everything in color. And since I was too young to know what love was, I wanted to eat creation." As the artist of your own story, contemplate the color of love. Nothing can happen nowhere. The locale of the happening always colors the happening and often to a degree shapes it. The fact that I was born in an isolated town may be the reason that I sought out infinity. I wanted to draw my soul, and then I wanted to draw all of the opposing elements in creation united, and then I wanted to draw eternity. We're going to do that together now. Take your dot, one dot, and draw a circle around your dot. Follow that circle round and round. Draw an ever-ending form, never-ending circle. What Madame Blavatsky called an ever-eternal nature, sexless and infinite. The circle is a synthesis of the greatest oppositions, said the artist Vasily Kandinsky, claiming that the circle is the most peaceful shape and it represents the human soul. This is a meeting place for all peoples of the world, the circle. I look in the mirror. What is circular in my human form? It is a pupil in my iris, likened to the middle of a circle. A circle with a point in its center represents the awakening of the universe. A circle with the point in its center is the chemical symbol for both the sun and gold, and also for you as your own center. We see not only with our eyes, but with all that we are and all that our culture is. The artist is a professional seer, wrote Dorothea Lange. As the artist of your own seer, of your own story, pardon me, become a professional seer. I am 2 years old when I begin to draw myself in Wells. Inside my house with the lights on, I close my eyes and I pick up a pencil. I take the soft yellow wood of my HB and chew on it. I examine its lead center, and then I place a dot of self on my paper, and then I move my pencil out. Not only is the point placed on my blank paper of utmost significance, but my blank paper surrounding it is also just as significant too. I am moving my pencil in a wild abandon of expression. Do this, everyone. Move your pencil in a wild abandon of expression. Making art in Wells made life there simply rapturous. I drew without mercy. My whole little body is a yellow pencil as I gleefully charge around the pathway circling Snob Hill in my too tight white patent shoes that are dusty and yellow grass stained. You can't find shoes that fit in Wells, my mother had explained. But I don't care that my feet hurt. This is a magical wildflower wilderness, and I'm in it. I pick purple lupine, red Indian paintbrush, and yellow buttercups. I blow dandelions into the blue and then attempt to catch them. I scratch gooey sap from the spruce trees. I play. I play and I transcend my thinking mind. By transcending my thinking mind, I'm releasing any opposition I hold towards anything. I'm letting go of right and wrong and inviting them to play together. Movement is synonymous with changing my experience. I have only one response to the vibrations of my universe, only one response to my longing, and only one way to grow and then to transform myself. I must move. As the artist of your own story, take your intention and move. In Nietzsche's view, the fundamental metaphysical activity of a human and the highest form of human activity is creating art. Art is a stimulant to life as an expression of the will to power. For a stimulant to life is what propels and advances it, what lifts a thing beyond itself. It is an increase of power. The artists call it scribbling. I'm just a child, you might say, but what would this babe in the woods know about being creative? What could she know about art? It was simple. I was doing what I did not know how to do so that I might learn how to do it. As the artists of your own story, do what you do not know how to do so that you might learn how to do it. My pencil had become my wings. Round and round the bends of the company-built miners' homes on Snob Hill, I run as my two small white patent shoes become rain and then snow boots. My eyes are searchlights, seeking out every curve of every tree trunk and every knob of hill. I bang the gate in our picket fence. I hug the towering fir tree growing beside the door. I'm home. Snuggled on the rug by the fire, I paint into view the ice-covered pools that I've negotiated, the fistful of frozen evergreen boughs that I've picked, and the chickadee I watched looping over the snowbanks. I listened to and heard the chickadee. There's a lot of difference between listening and hearing, said Kate Chesterton. As the artist of your own story, learn the difference between listening and hearing. It is understanding. Where I was in our cozy little company plant home mattered, but what I was doing there by making art would come to mean everything. I take out my finger paints. I'm uncensored and undisciplined. I am free. I am abstract expressionist Jackson Pollock, though I've never heard of him, and I'm producing my first drip and splash paintings. I am nature, just as he said he was. I dip my whole hand and splash and smudge yellow into red and make orange. Then I swirl yellow into blue and make green, and then blue into red to make purple. Then I pour the rest of the paint on my paper and smudging everything together, make mud. This is action painting. I leave my wet finger paints on the sofa and Uncle Wilfred sits on them in his new suit. I also followed what Ezra Pound advised, and made the world strange. In Wells, I didn't have to try too hard to do this. In Wells, at night, cozy in my bed, there was not one sentence in need of a period being uttered at all. I finished my drawing and running around Snob Hill for the day, and alone in my dark room, I feel myself to be a tiny, singular point of life. I'm almost an invisible thing. This is lonely, being the point of my existence in my bed all by myself. Who cares? Then I see through my bedroom window the moon and the stars are glistening sparks of light and that the branches of our fir tree reaches out to embrace them. And I know that there's more than just me here. But I need more now. What I really need is for you to come and tuck me in again, Mom, and give me another goodnight hug. If I'm the point of creation, then you are too, Mum, and I like it best when our points snuggle. So now draw a point of yourself on your paper again and draw another point near it. And now you're not alone. There's another, just the same as you, in this world. We are the points of creation. I'm beginning to understand no matter how small my actions are, they make a difference. I'd been busy following chickadee when the sky suddenly darkened right in the middle of the day. The fir trees began to shudder and the icicle windows of our small home rattled. The wind announced her gruff arrival as she rose higher than Cow Mountain, and heaving her heavy backside away from our little village below, she swung her wide mouth around. She slurred and then shouted bad words that hollered down upon us as frozen particles that sting and stick on everything. I run for home. I open the door. My entire little body is used to close it tight. The year of impact is 1951. Safe and defrosting, my hands on my spot, on our rag rug, I begin to overhear a conversation my parents are telling. Stories, only these are not fairy tales. These stories from an Eastern European nightmare are more terrible than anything I could dream or imagine. Stories of a lust for power that raged through Europe from 1933 to 1945 had arrived at our little white picket fenced house on Snob Hill. Shattering through our picket fence and hissing down our chimney in the middle of winter, they threatened to blow our whole house down with little me in it. I could not imagine the details or comprehend their meaning. I was just a little girl, but this was a blow to my innocent spirit, and I would carry the impact of this telling for the rest of my existence. I was not only a visual thinker, I was feeling my visual thoughts, and I wanted to have friends. Take your dots and make lots of dots on your page. We are all in this together. My visual thoughts upon hearing the story were black. I wanted to run into the storm and hide my feelings in the white on white, and I wandered deeper into the forest. I wander and I watch how the natural spaces between each tree lets the light shine in and enables each tree room to grow. Why is it so hard to learn that the spaces between living things is vital to their existence? As the artist of your own story, employ your intuition, the knowing that comes from inside. Wander, guided by your intuition, and observe and then absorb your world with a child's pure heart. Then I sat down among the trees, staring, like my grandfather and like Emily Carr. See all the points of creation together. I painted, and as I grew into my adult self, I strengthened my intention to stay in the light. I wanted to be an alchemist of light. I did this because I wanted to grow. I paint and I paint. Grandmother Tree has struggled with all her life force. I paint for culture. I paint for her. She struggled to grow herself strong so that she may become a sanctuary for others. Then I created these for paintings for Raincoast Environmental Foundation in support of the black bear and the salmon. And then between the pillars, I paint for culture. When mountains of eyeglasses and shoes are all that remains of a large portion of a sacred ancient people, all of creation is harmed. My lines that I draw every day since I'm a little girl have evolved into a form in my adulthood. I draw doves. I draw doves every day. They swirl into existence on any available surface within my reach, especially the pages of my day journal. They stretch their wings skyward while carrying within them a forgotten cedar or olive branch, or the embellishment of leaves, roses, or geometric patterning. These doves I draw represent my state of soul and my consciousness in the moments I am drawing them. They become a meditation that enables me to transcend the chaos of existence. Each of my doves is a sacred shape. I have returned from drawing them able to express the sorrow and to paint hope upon the industrial logging that has clear-cut huge sections of the old-growth forest surrounding Wells and the Torah scrolls that have been purposefully dislodged from their mantles to be torn, burned, and desecrated. I have returned from drawing doves, ready to paint the betrayal of the earth in the haphazard overcutting that I found strewn about the home we once lived in, my crying house. I returned from drawing doves, able to paint resistance and then protection upon this overcutting. I'm flying with the eagle, high above the smoking embers that at a moment's flash will rage again in wildfires of ecocide and genocide. I trust my intuition. All art is exorcism. Painting is a way to produce order in yourself. There is much chaos in me, much chaos in our time. Otto Dix. Drawing doves every day enables me to mirror what I have seen back to heaven. Chaos in our time. My great-grandmother is in the moon. Great-grandmother Bessie had a beautiful face. I know this, and stared into it in the only remaining photograph from our Lithuanian family. Your face is a language, great-grandmother. I want to read your clear, bright eyes in this black and white photograph that will not reveal their color. I want to read the storylines indented in your forehead, and I want to understand the humble phrases in your soft silver hair and the pauses in the commas at each end of your mouth that are just like mine. I place your photograph into the full October moon that I imagine you rising from within a desecrated Warsaw cemetery. Here your gentle, strong bearing will reside amidst trees that reach up their boughs to question both earth and heaven. Four of us, two artists and two poets, have been the recipients of a Canada Council grant to create a book sharing reverence between our two nations. Before I can begin this new body of artworks, I feel the urgency to return to Wells and then to Barkerville and walk back from the furthest point of town. I'm returning home to ask for a blessing. This painting, A Sacred Voice is Calling, was painted on my way there while I obtained permission to use this quote by Chief Black Cloud. And then I paint my grandmother in my studio. I paint her beside my friend and brother, George Littlechild, as he paints his grandmother, Bella. They are both handsome, our grandmothers. Mine is sitting in an elaborately carved chair with an open book in her hands. Stories would be her refuge. Then I paint my dreams for this book and visions too. This is also a second painting we did called Two Nations, One Voice of George's grandfather. And since I had no one left of the rabbis from my family and no photographs, I was able to obtain this image from the archives. I dreamt I needed a real yellow star to put into a work of art. And then Renier brought me hers. In a ceremonial fashion, she gives it to me, saying that it will do more good in a work of art than in her drawer. Then she reads me the letter that she had written to her mother, who she last saw alive 50 years earlier. I create a work of art with photographs of her family so she can write her letter into it. I paint the tracks to Auschwitz and a cattle car filled with human beings. The painting is called The Sky Was as Black as a Cow's Eye. I photographed the cows of the caribou to place them into my artwork. Then I paint my daughter's journey to Eastern Europe. She was only young, 17 years old then, when she had the vision of children that she saw in the sky above Warsaw. This painting is for the children, and my daughter wrote a poem to them within it. I paint the aftermath of the war and new hope using photographs of myself and my friend in Wells and my husband, Michael, as a little boy holding the newspaper in Toronto, before and after. Then, Mansi, I meet her when she decides she will continuously follow me around. She wants to tell me how her mother's tablecloth was her luck and how it saved her life after the war. I put Mansi in the center of her mother's tablecloth and wrote her story all around its edges. The Weeping Dove. When it was mysteriously handed to me, I painted the story of a group of young female students who committed suicide rather than submit to the German soldiers who were coming to them. This led me to the Gesture Project, where I facilitated, along with a writer and a psychologist and a scribe, the processing of trauma between the generations of the Holocaust experience. We are choosing photographs to put into their images. I had them enlarged and put on fiber-based paper. This is Lillian Borax-Nemetz, and this is her finished image, painting the wall, the Warsaw Ghetto wall surrounding her. This is Frances Hoyd with her image, my family. And this is Malka with her image of herself, which she calls herself as a little girl, the mother to her mother, because she saved her mother's life. Her mother was so traumatized that Malka took her hand and took her hiding in the bushes to go to farmers' homes in the evening. And luckily enough, they were taken in. The Gesher Project, its stories, poetry, and exercises, the sharing of secrets, the singing of songs, and most importantly, the taking down of barriers of silence between the generations, and the creation of a visual place to hold their lost ones, had a profound impact upon all of us. At the end of the project, when my studio was returned to me, I longed to paint flowers. I carried a glorious bouquet into my studio, but this painting resulted. I had taken on too much trauma, painting after image. I decided the only way to release these stories would be to find more of my own. I went to Lithuania to find my grandmother Fanny's village, for I knew that it meant home to her. I paint my return as a dove form carrying a rose whose petals are falling back to home. With three of my children and a guide and driver, we set out for Vorner, a village in the northwestern part of the country. This was a surreal combination of dream and reality, for I felt that I almost floated there. I floated when I met the one surviving Jewish woman in the village who had hidden the pig pens and since married a villager. I floated when I heard that although they have come to record them from Oxford, her husband has forbidden her to sing her Yiddish lullabies. Then I float through the graveyard with its indecipherable worn stones, and then I shatter when I look into Zita's eyes as her story is translated for us. A most shocking discovery in my grandmother's little village of Vorner, Lithuania, was that it looked almost exactly like my birthplace in the Canadian wilderness. From light to darkness, synagogue and ecclesia. The church and the synagogue in the Middle Ages are depicted as women. Ecclesia, the church, is shown to be triumphant with the rise of Christianity, while synagogue is blindfolded and her staff broken. These statues still stand in cathedrals and churches in Europe today. I paint the redemption of synagogue. Myself holding menorah with images of synagogue and ecclesia floating around me, while all the valorous Jewish female friends and family I know cover my dress. I become the first artist commissioned to do paintings for the Trans-Canada Trail, the Golden Journey, Sunlight's Passages, and Sanctuary. Then I paint the Singing Tree for the Red Cross in support of forest fire relief. And then I paint From Waterborne that becomes a poster for the Breast Cancer Foundation in Canada. I'm then taken to Haida Gwaii with 50 other Western Canadian artists to create a book in support of nature and against the proposed pipeline. It is a magical journey. Melissa, a teen First Nations, approaches me as I sit on a log on the beach at Hakai, painting the forest behind. She is watching me work in silence. Then suddenly she takes her finger and dips it into the hot pink color on my palette and then picks up a shell and paints it with her finger. We smile and become friends. Melissa makes me a gift of shells, feathers, stones, and driftwood, and I in turn give her paints, paper, and brushes. This is Haida Gwaii. Look deeply into nature and you will understand everything better, said Albert Einstein. I am in the Creator's tent again, only realizing that it extends from my heart to the heart of creation. As artists of your story, you are in the Creator's tent. Nature, your soul's artist, evoking creativity and enabling life, and you to become a work of art. Thank you very much. And now, there's a noble teacher and scholar here today who, as the artist of her own story, has sanctified her sacred pathway, to return to her ancestral Stolo land as a great leader and champion of human dignity. I call upon Chancellor Gwen Point. When I met you for the first time last year when I was honored at your noble university, you silently put your hand to your heart and then you gave it to me. I want to do the same and give my heart to you. And with it, my painting, Tree of My Life. I give you the gratitude with all my heart for the gift that you are to this creation. Come.
So you know, the painting here, titled Tree of Life, will be in Alumni Hall here in the building just outside and upstairs from where we sit, and a plaque commemorating this gracious and beautiful gift will accompany this painting in Alumni Hall. Thank you.
Well, Linda, you spoke of the magic of creation, and when we gave you the title doctor, we should have added magician. You spoke of the, and inspired us to create ourselves, to be the authors, the artists of our own stories. You inspire us, to use your words, to repair a world that we have torn, and you inspire us to paint our world in the colors of love and light, and for that we thank you.